Hey everybody, welcome to the next session on ADSP. Today we will talk about the Z-transform. The Z-transform is a more general transform than the Fourier transform, and we will use it to obtain perfect reconstruction in filter banks and wavelets. Hence we will now look at the effects of sampling and some more tools in the Z-domain. Since usually we deal with causal systems, in practice we use the one-sided Z-transform defined as this formula here. It's basically turning a sequence x of n into a polynomial x of z, right? Starting with index number 0. And that makes sense because causal systems don't have non-zero values for indices smaller than 0. So first observe then this way that we get our usual frequency response or the discrete time Fourier transform for causal signals starting at n equals 0 if we evaluate the Z transform along the unit circle in the Z domain. So we just make this substitution and then we get the DTFT. So this is true when we have causal signals which start at n equals 0. So in general we can write complex variable z with an angle and a magnitude. So r is the magnitude and capital omega is the angle. And this capital omega is also the normalized angular frequency, and the r is a damping factor for an exponentially decaying oscillation. So if r is smaller than 1, then we have a damped oscillation. If r is larger than 1, we have an exponentially growing oscillation. So this damping factor is not in the DTFT. There the r is always 1. So this means in the Z-transform we can have a converging sum of the transform even for unstable signals or system by just choosing r large enough. This means the region of convergence just becomes smaller. Remember, in the Z transform, we have the factor z to the minus 1 is 1 over r times e to the minus j omega. So here are some properties of the Z transform. First, we have the shift property. So we can take causal sequences. Causal here means we have no negative indices, no non-zero values for negative indices, and we have two sequences xn and xn minus 1, which is the same sequence but delayed by one sample. Then we can see how they are connected in the Z transform. So here's the Z transform of the original. And here's the Z-transform of the delayed version. So the connection is not quite clear yet, but when we do the index substitution, n prime becomes n minus 1, then we can see it. So we just plug it into the sum here. So then the sum again starts at 0. Here we have n prime, but now in the exponent we have n prime plus 1. So now we can factor out this plus 1 as z to the minus 1 in front of the sum, and then the sum becomes the z-transform of the non-shifted version. So this then shows that a delay by one sample in the signal domain, the time domain, corresponds to the multiplication of z to the minus 1 in the z-domain, which you can see here. So the delay by one sample turns into a delay by z to the minus 1. So this is very practical, because the n minus 1 is difficult to capture mathematically, but the multiplication with z to the minus 1 can, for instance, be factored out of a sum. So here's an example. We have a sequence of just three numbers, 1, 2, 3. In the time domain and in the Z domain, it becomes this polynomial. When we take the delayed signal, we start with 0 and then 1, 2, 3, we have almost the same polynomial, just that the first index now is a 0, And this polynomial is can be obtained by just multiplying the first polynomial with c to the minus 1. So this shows our rule. So then we come to the Z-transform domain properties. Recommended reading is this book by Al Oppenheim and Ronald Schaefer, Discrete Time Signal Processing from Prentice Hall. Related to the shift property of the Z-transform is the shifted unit pulse. We can apply what we just learned. The unit pulse is simply 1 at position 0 and 0 everywhere else. So if you apply the Z-transform, then we just get a 1, right? It's the first index of a polynomial. Then we can shift this unit pulse by d samples. So now it appears at position number d, and that means we just have a coefficient 1 for the corresponding z, which is z to the minus d. Right? So this is to expect. So the next simple property is linearity. When we multiply a sequence by a constant factor a, then this constant factor a also applies to the z-transform. Right? It's basically you increase all the coefficients or decrease by this factor. And the same holds true for the summation. If you sum two sequences, then this is the same as summing the z-transforms of the two. So this tells you that it doesn't matter if you sum before the z-transform or sum after the z-transform. Then we have the convolution property. And here we see that the z-transform turns a convolution into a product. Here convolution in time is a product in the z-domain. And this is a very important property of the z-transform, because convolution mathematically is more complicated than the multiplication. So remember, the convolution is defined as the sum here. And when you look at the sum here, the indices add up to n. And this is basically the same that you would get if you multiply two polynomials, right? So this product would lead to the same exponent. And that means multiplying two polynomials gives you the same coefficients as convolving the two coefficient sequences. Yeah, so this is one of the main advantages of the Z-transform, since it turns a convolution into a simpler multiplication, which in principle is invertible. So here's an example of the Z-transform, an exponential decaying sequence. So we have x of n equals p to the nth power, starting for n equals 0 and going up. So that means we have to sequence 1, p, p squared, p to the third, and so on. So in general, this goes on to infinity. And this is in principle a geometric sum, right? It has this form. And for this, we got the solution. So this is this closed form solution of the sum. Except now the sum goes to infinity. So n goes towards infinity. So we have the expression c to the nth power here. And if n magnitude is smaller, strictly smaller than 1, then this expression goes to 0. It disappears. So then we have, now we have c equals p times z to the minus 1. And that means if p times z to the minus 1 magnitude is strictly smaller than 1, then we can make this simplification. And for the z-transform, we get 1 divided by 1 minus p to the times z to the minus 1. Or if we expand it by z with z, then we get z divided by z minus p. So now we can see here that we have a pole at position z equals p. So when if z is p, then this becomes 0 and we have a pole. And we have a 0 at position z equals 0. Hence, if you know the pole position, we know p. And if we know p, we know the time sequence. Well, except for a constant factor. So the location of the pole gives us very important information about the signal. K keep in mind that this solution is only valid for all p which fulfill magnitude p times z to the minus 1 strictly smaller than 1. So that means magnitude z is larger than p. This is called the region of convergence, or ROC. The ROC is connected to the resulting stability of the system, or signal. The region of convergence is outside the pole location. If the region of convergence includes the unit circle, which describes constant bounded oscillations, we have a stable system. This means if the poles are inside the unit circle, we have a stable system. The sum of x of n converges. If we get this sum, we get the sum if we set z equals 1. If magnitude of p, abs of p, is strictly smaller than 1. In this case, we also say that the signal or system is stable. Meaning, for a bounded input, we obtain a bounded output, a so-called Biot stability. In this case, we see that the resulting pole of our z-transform is inside the unit circle. If magnitude of p is larger than 1, we have an exponential growth of the impulse response, which is basically an exploding signal system, meaning the output grows towards infinity, hence it is unstable. In general, we see that the system or signal is stable if the poles of its z-transform are inside the unit circle in the z-domain, or unstable if at least one pole is outside the unit circle. It will exponentially grow. So these are the basic properties which can be used to derive z-transforms of more complicated expressions, and they can also be used to obtain an inverse z-transform by inspection. For instance, if we see a fraction with a pole in the z-transform, we know that the underlying time sequence has an exponential decay or oscillation in it. Observe that we can obtain a real-valued decayed oscillation if we have two poles, each the conjugate complex of the other, or one with plus omega and one with minus omega. In this way, we cancel the imaginary part. One of the main differences of the z-transform compared to the discrete-time Fourier transform is that with the z-transform, we can see if a signal system is stable by looking at the position of the poles in the z-domain. This is not possible for the DTFT, since there we don't know the positions of the poles. So should be known. So now we take a look at our downsample signal from last time. Take our signal x of n and multiply it by the unit pulse train, delta n. And we describe this unit pulse train as the sum of exponentials, which you can see here. So now we can z-transform this expression, like here. And we can see here, again, we can nicely combine the exponents here, or these two expressions. So when you look at it, we see that we basically get, see this, we can basically draw this outside here, and then x times this expression looks like the z transform, where we replace z by this product, z times e to the minus j 2 pi over n times k, and here the n is the common exponent, which is part of the z transform. So basically, now the z transform has this factor e to the minus j 2 pi over n times k in front of the z, and we have this sum over the k's. So that means we have now our alias components, and they appear by multiplying z with e to the minus j 2 pi over n times k. Right? So this multiplication of z with this exponential expression is in effect a shift of the frequency as before. You can see this if you replace z by e to the minus j omega, and then we have just omega plus 2 pi over n times k. Right, so again, a frequency shift. So remember from last time, the effect is the removal or the the effect from the removal or reinsertion of the zero, changing the sampling rate for from or into the signal XD at the higher sampling rate, and YM at the lower sampling rate. I should correct this effect of the removal. So in the Z domain, this is similar. It's like scaling in the frequency. So here we have the exponent 1 over n, and if you see e to the j omega as z, then we have omega divided by capital N. So again, same kind of scaling from sampling rate change. So this leads us now to filters. So filters are linear time invariant systems. This means they fulfill the following properties. So f is our filter, and the argument is the signal x of n. So x of n is our input signal. Then we have the linearity, which means if we have two signals, x1 and x2, then the filter of the sum of the two signals is the same as first filtering each and then adding them after the filtering operation. Similar with the factor A, if we apply the filter to the signal scaled by this factor A, then it's the same as first filtering the signal and then multiplying it with A. So this means we can draw out sums and factors out of our function. Also, usually we want to have time invariance. That means it doesn't matter at what time we apply our function or filter. So if we get a delayed signal and apply it to the filter, we just get a delayed output, which means our function or filter stays the same no matter when we apply it. A simple finite impulse response filter, or FIR filter, has a difference equation like the following. With x of n, the input of our filter, and y of n, its output, we get this equation here. So the output is simply a weighted sum of the past L input samples. So starting from the present, where m is equal to 0, and then we go into the past, L samples into the past, and each delayed sample gets its own weight, b of m. So this can be seen as a weighted average. And those b's can also have negative values. So when you look at the sum here, you see this typical inversion of the sign of the index. Here it's negative, here it's positive. So this is a convolution of the signal x of n with b of n. Right? We basically convolve x and b. And the b are the coefficients of the filter or its impulse response. So these coefficients are also commonly referred to as tabs because the system can be viewed as tapping a delay line as seen in the picture below. So this difference equation is also how usually filters are implemented, for instance in Python or other programming languages. A typical block diagram of an FIR filter is like this. So we have the input, signal x, then we have a delay chain. So after each block z to the minus 1, we have one sample older, right? So this is x of n minus 1, x of n minus 2, here we have x of n minus n. And for each delayed version, we have its own factor b. So this picture is actually from this Wikipedia page. So observe that here the blocks with z to the minus 1 are implemented with a delay by one sampling interval, not a multiplication with z to the minus 1 as we would do in the D domain, in the Z domain. Yeah, so at the first delay, block z to the minus 1, we have x of n minus 1, as I just mentioned, then we have x of n minus 2, and so on. So each delay block memorizes the value from the left for one sample clock cycle and then releases it to the right at the next sample clock cycle. Hence the delay, they delay samples by one sample at a time or one sample clock cycle. So now we can take a look at the Z transform of our difference equation of our convolution. So again, here our convolutional equation. And then we can take the linearity and delay property of the Z transform and simplify it. So here we get the Z transform of the output. And since this is a sum, we can take the Z transform of each of the summands. And since this is a constant factor, we can take the Z transform just of x of n minus m. And this is the delayed version of x of n. So hence, this is the Z transform of x times z to the minus 1. So this is what we see here. So that's convenient because this x of z does not depend on m, right? So we can factor it out. And then what's left is this sum here. And this sum simply is the z transform of the impulse response b. Right? So that means now we can compute the transfer function of this filter, defined as the output divided by the input. So y of z divided by x of z, and that's simply the z transform of the coefficients b of our impulse response. Right? Very convenient. So we just need to take our coefficients b, apply the z transform, and then we have the transfer function of our filter. So when we have the transfer function, we can also compute or obtain the frequency response so that we can see which frequencies are attenuated and which are not from our transfer function of the filter by just replacing z by e to the j omega, because then we obtain the DTFT. So here we have e to the j omega, here we have e to the j omega, and now we can simply plug some frequency numbers in the normalized frequency omega, and we can sample the transfer function and plot it. Since e to the j omega is a complex number, our frequency response in general is also complex. Hence, h is a complex number for each frequency omega. Usually it's plotted as a magnitude plot and a phase plot over frequency. Its magnitude tells us the attenuation at each frequency, and the phase, its phase shift for each frequency. Using those two plots or properties, we can also design our filters with desired properties, for instance, stop band at given frequencies. The MATLAB and Python function to generate a magnitude and phase plot of a transfer function or signal is FrecZ, which we already saw. So FrecZ simply takes an array for omega and then computes the magnitude and phase for them. So next is IIR filters or infinite impulse response filters. So their difference equations is like this. So the first part looks like our FIR filter, but then there is another part which now takes past output samples. So you can see here past output samples, and that's why the sum also starts at 1. Because we cannot take the current output sample because that's not computed yet. So here you can also read more about it in this book by Oppenheim Schaefer, Discrete Time Signal Processing. So here we indeed have two convolutions. Observe the feedback from the output y back to the input and the sum. Also observe that the feedback part starts with a delay of r equals 1, as I just said. This is because we want to avoid so-called delayless loops, because they are a problem. We cannot use this value before we computed it. Again, this difference equation is the usual implementation using MATLAB or Octave or Python. The following image shows the corresponding block diagram of our filter. So here you can see it. So the beginning looks like our FIR filter, but then we have another feedback loop at the output here, where we put the output in this delay line and feed it back to the input. So the boxes with z to the minus 1 again are the delays by one sample. We can now also simplify the structure by combining the summations, like in this picture here. So this has the advantage that we have fewer sum elements. Right? So basically, since because of linearity, we can do this. Yeah, and when we want to compute the transfer function, we can apply the Z transform to this difference equation, and this is what we get, as before, using the linearity property of the Z transform. And here we should observe that MATLAB and Octave and Python, SciPy signal L filter, are defining the coefficients A with opposite signs, as we and Oppenheim-Schaefer are defining. You can see this by typing help L filters or help filter or help SciPy signal L filter in Python. So we have to be careful with this sign here. This can be minus. To obtain the transfer function, we first move the y to one side. So since we had a plus here, we get a minus here, but it might be plus. For instance, for Python, there's a plus here, which has its advantages, but then there would be a minus here. So you have to be careful how it's defined. So now we have this polynomial on the left-hand side, and for the transfer function, we just need to divide it, bring it on the other side. This is what you can see here. So y divided by x is the z transform of the b coefficients divided by 1 minus the z transform of the a coefficients. Or if you include the 1 as the sequence for the coefficients, and it's the z transform of the feedback loop and z transformed. Yeah, so again, with the help of the Z transform, we were able to find a closed form solution for the transfer function, even though we have a feedback loop in our system. So this is also a big advantage for the Z transform. Otherwise, it would be really difficult to capture this feedback loop in a closed form solution. Yeah, so here we can see that we obtain a polynomial in the denominator of our transfer function, and hence we obtain poles. Right. So this is different from the FIR filter where we just had zeros. Here now we have significant poles. That means that the filter can potentially become unstable if they are outside the unit circle. The zeros of this denominator polynomial become the poles of the transfer functions. So if these poles are all inside the unit circle, we indeed have a stable filter. So we need to make sure that this is the case. This also shows that we just need to design our coefficients A such that the poles are inside the unit circle for stability. Yeah, so we can take a look at figure 1 for the structure and shift the delays z to the minus 1 after the multiplication and obtain the following structure. Here the circles symbolize a multiplication with the values inside the unit circle. So you can see it. So here we have the factors, here's the summation, and here's the delay line for the FIR filter. And when we have the feedback part, we have a similar structure, except that now the A's come from the outside, right? We just put the delays on the other side now. So now we can combine those two structures to get a simplified version. So we have a combined FIR-IR structure, which is used in Python L filter. So the previous structures had the delays in the middle. Since the delay is a linear operator, we can shift it after a summation and hence can combine the delay chain for the FIR and IR part. This reduces the memory requirements and leads to the following structure. So this reduces the memory requirements for an implementation and leads to this structure here. So here you can see now the central elements are the delays, and they are reused for the feedback part, the B's, the feedforward part, and here the feedback part for the IIR part. And this is useful because often the delays are more expensive than the summations. The delays usually involve memory element, and memory elements are usually more critical for an implementation than summation elements. So here's a little filter example. So going back to the simple example of an exponential decaying signal, this shows how to implement it. So we just need a system with a pole at position P. In the above equation, we obtain it by setting P0 equals 1, A1 equals P. And hence, we obtain the simple difference equation, y of n equals x plus p times y of n minus 1. Right, and if you look at it, we can compute the impulse response. So if x of n is a unit pulse, then the output is the exponential decaying sequence 1, p, p squared, and so on. Because each time we take the previous output and multiply it by p. So we get an infinitely long impulse response, hence the name IIR. And in a block diagram, you can also write it like this. You have some input, then the output is delayed, multiplied by p, and put into the sum, and again. So it goes into this loop forever, and we have this exponential decaying sequence. Yeah. So in the z-domain, we have this formulation. So y is x plus p times z to the minus 1 times y of z. And the transfer function accordingly is 1 divided by 1 minus p times z to the minus 1. So this is now the result of the feedback loop. So observe that this is the same as the z-transform of our exponential series before. So this means when we transform this back into the time domain, we obtain an exponential function, which is the filter's impulse response, which confirms what we just saw by using an impulse in the time domain for our filter. So the result of the inverse z-transform of our transform function is indeed this exponential decaying sequence. So now we, again in this example, we see this connection between the exponential decaying sequence and this pole at position P. Yeah, so now we can compute the resulting frequency response using Frexi. We also have a Python Frexi function also in Moodle, which automatically plots. And this can be used to plot the magnitude and phase plot of the transfer function of this filter. Its inputs are directly the coefficients a and b of the transfer function in this form. So first argument is b, second argument is a. So we choose a1 equals p equals 0.9. Remember that a0, a of 0 is 1 by default. And we obtain these arrays. So a, here's the first one, here's the minus 0.9. And b just has the 1 because we have no FIR part. Then we just type Frexi, get w as the frequency samples and h as the complex frequency response. And then we get this plot, which we actually have to do ourselves. So let's see if we can do it. Somehow it disappeared, I guess. Okay, so now let's compute our frequency response of our simple example using IPython, PyLab. So we use Frexi, and we do that conveniently inside IPython minus PyLab. So we can just open a terminal window, and I prepared this little example. So here, basically, we just type IPython minus PyLab. Then we are opening the PyLab window. We are in interactive mode, and then we can just basically define our vectors. So here's the vector a, the one in the beginning, which is there by default, and then the factor p with a minus sign, because that's what Python expects here, so minus 0.9, and then the b is just the 1, since we have no FIR coefficients. So now we can import Frexy, and I'm using the Frexy that you can find in Moodle, in Moodle 2, because that includes the plot function. So it's just convenient. Otherwise, just take the Frexy from SciPy Signal. That works too, but then you have to plot separately. So then we just apply Frexy, and this is now the frequency plot that we are getting. So here you can see on the top part we have the magnitude in dB, and you can see here in the passband actually it has 20 dB gain. So that's a peculiarity of our filter here, that we actually have a lot of gain in the passband. And it behaves like a low-pass filter. It then has more and more attenuation when you go to higher frequencies. Although it's kind of a bad low-pass filter, because it has the slow slope towards high frequencies. And finally we end up with at minus 5 dB. So here we have, from passing to stopping, about 25 dB. Here in the lower plot you can see the phase. And you can see that the phase here is highly nonlinear, right? This is unlike symmetric FIR filters, where we have a straight curve, a linear function. Here we have a very nonlinear phase curve. And that's a typical sign for IIR filters, which in general have this nonlinear phase functions. Okay. So, going back to the slides. So here's the plot that we just saw. And observe that the frequency axis goes from 0 to 3.14. So it actually ends here. And this is the normalized frequency for Nyquist. So this is the Nyquist frequency, or half the sampling frequency. Yeah, so we saw it's basically a low-pass filter. It passes DC and it attenuates higher frequencies. So now we can use the command zplane, which we also have in Moodle, to plot the location of the zeros and poles in the complex zplane. Right, so we first need to calculate the pole and zero positions. With a Python function np roots. So we are interested in the poles, so roots needs to find the zeros of the denominator, so this polynomial. Right, and this is kind of easy. You can see it by inspection. So the root here is at position p. Right, so the roots expects as argument the ordered coefficients of our polynomial in z to the minus 1, which makes it compatible to L filter. So again, this is kind of convenient. We don't need to reformulate it in terms of z. So hence our pole positions are at np roots of a, and the zeros at np roots of b. So a contains our coefficients 1 and minus 0.9. So basically we can now just execute this in our IPython window. So we go here, paste it, and here we see we have a pole at position 0.9 as expected. So this is how you would do it in general, even though if you have longer sequences or higher order polynomials in the denominator, where you cannot see it by inspection, but you can still use roots to get all the pole positions. Then we can simply plot their positions using our command zplane. So same approach from zplane, import zplane, that's the function. This is the library, this is the function, and then we simply plot roots of b, this is on the poles, and here this is the zeros and this is the poles for a. So we can also copy and paste this. So copy and then paste it into our Python window, and this is what we get, right? So we get a nice circle here, and we can see here's this cross, and this cross is for the pole that we have at this location. And when you look at it, it's for 0.9 and 0 on the imaginary axis. So this is 0.9 is the pole location as expected. Okay. So here, this is what we just saw. And zeros are marked with a 0 and poles are marked with an X. So here, what's interesting is the pole location at z equals 0.9. So in general, the closer a pole is to the unit circle, the larger is the corresponding peak in the magnitude of the frequency response at a normalized frequency identical to the angle of the pole to the origin. So in our case, the angle was 0 since the pole was on the real axis. And that's why we have this peak in the magnitude at normalized frequency 0, as we indeed saw in our Frexi plot. Yeah, so this can be seen by turning the Z transform into a DTFT, the discrete time Fourier transform, by replacing Z by e to the j omega. Right? So hence the frequency response is obtained by running on this unit circle. Omega is our angle and also normalized frequency, and the closer we get to a pole, the higher the magnitude of the frequency response becomes. This is opposite for zeros. The closer we come to a zero, the smaller the magnitude of the frequency response becomes. Here our pole has an angle of 0 degrees. In the example, we can indeed observe a peak in the magnitude response at normalized frequency omega equals 0 in this plot above. The filtering operation itself works similar in MATLAB or Octave or Python in the time domain. The function is filter or L-filter in Python. Given an input signal in the vector x and filter coefficients in vectors a and b, the filtered output y of our filter is simply y equals L filter of b, a, x. Often use orders of the zeros and poles L and R are a few dozen coefficients. Right, so here these are the orders of the polynomials that we have here. So usually, especially for the feedback path, it's not that many, because the higher order we have for the denominator polynomial, the more difficult it becomes to keep it stable. So here's another Python example. We use the function L-filter to obtain the impulse response of this IRR filter. Right. So again, in IPython minus PyLab, we use SciPy signal because that contains the L-filter. Now we generate the unit pulse, starting with zeros, and then set the first entry to 1. This is our unit pulse followed by 9 zeros. Here again, the same coefficients as before, and now we use them in SciPy signal L filter. Right. So we can actually take this code and just copy and paste it. So copy and then paste it into our IPython window. Oh, I forgot to import. import scipy signal, copy, paste. So now doing the same thing again. X is not defined. So what's the problem now? Somehow I must have missed this. So copy. Now try this again. Yeah, now it works. So here you can see the sample number and here the value. And first sample is 1 for the unit pulse, and then the next sample is 0.9, then 0.9 squared, 0.9 to the third power, and so on. So indeed we see we have this exponential decaying function as expected. Right, so we get this picture here, which is just the sequence of powers of 0.9. And in this way we can also test more complicated IR filters where it's not so obvious. Right? We just use a unit pulse followed by zeros, and the number of zeros determine the length of the output that we get, and then we get the impulse response at the according length. Yeah, so this exponential decaying impulse response again shows the stability of the filter, which was to be expected because the pole of its transfer function in the Z domain is placed at Z equals 0.9 and hence inside the unit circle. Okay, that's it for today. Thank you for your attention, and then see you next time.